Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Most merciful God,
we confess that we are captive to sin and unhappy ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may make delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, the Father of our Lord Jesus, you are the city that shelters us, the mother who comforts us. With your Spirit, accompany us on our life's journey, that we may spread your peace in all the world through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
First reading is written in Isaiah, the 66th chapter. Rejoice with Jerusalem and be glad for her. All you who love her, rejoice with her in joy. All you who mourn over her, that you may nurse and be satisfied from her consoling breast, that you may drink deeply with delight from her glorious bosom. For thus says the Lord, I will extend prosperity to her like a river, and the wealth of the nations like an overflowing stream, and you shall nurse and be carried on her arm and dandled on her knees. As a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you. You shall be comforted in Jerusalem. You shall see, and your heart shall rejoice. Your bodies shall flourish like the grass, and it shall be known that the hand of the Lord is with his servants, and his indignation is against his enemies. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Are we singing or
reading?
Be joyful in God, all ye lands. Be joyful, all the earth.
Sing the glory of God's name. Sing the glory of God's praise.
Say to God, how awesome are your deeds. Because of your great strength, your enemies cringe before you.
All the earth bows down before you. Sing to you, sing out your name.
Come now and see the works of God. How awesome are God's deeds towards all people.
God turned the sea into dry land,
so that they went through the water on foot,
and they were rejoicing in God.
Ruling forever in might, God keeps watch over the nations. Let no rebels exalt themselves.
Bless the Lord, you peoples.
Let the sound of praise be heard.
Our God has kept us among the living and has not allowed our feet to slip. The second reading is from Galatians, the 6th chapter. My friends, if anyone is detected in a transgression, you who have received the Spirit should restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness. Take care that you yourselves are not tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. For if those who are nothing think they are something, they deceive themselves. All must test their work. Then that work, rather than their neighbor's work, will become a cause for pride. For all must carry their own loads. Those who are taught the word must share in all good things with their teacher. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for you reap whatever you sow. If you sow to your own flesh, you will reap corruption from the flesh. But if you sow to the Spirit, you will reap eternal life from the Spirit. So let us not grow weary in doing what is right, for what will we reap at harvest time if we do not give up. So then, whenever we have an opportunity, let us work for the good of all, and especially for those of the family of faith. See what large letters I make when I am writing in my own hand. It is those who want to make a good showing in the flesh that try to compel you to be circumcised, only that they may not be persecuted for the cross of Christ. Even the circumcised do not themselves obey the law, but they want you to be circumcised so that they may boast about your flesh. May I never boast about anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. For neither circumcision nor uncircumcision is anything, but a new creation. for those who will follow this rule, peace be upon them, and mercy, and upon the Israel of God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Praise to you, O Christ.
So all of our lessons today have to do with relationship, with community, ethnicity, and nationality. As the Israelites were going back to their home in Israel, Isaiah comforted them. Rejoice in Jerusalem and be glad for her, because they were going home. They were glad. He also told them what Jerusalem did for her, for them. Their home was a place of consoling, of delight, of prosperity, and they knew that their home welcomed. Paul then talks to the Galatians gentleness. Take care that you are not tempted. Bear one another's burdens. And in that way, you fulfill the law of Christ. Jesus sends out the 70, and we would be considered among the 70 to go and speak the word of God to the strangers. And he said, when they welcome you, sit down and eat what they give you. Now, didn't your mother say when you go to visit friends, you know, eat what they give you, don't have one? Well, Jesus was saying the same thing. But it was a little more dangerous because the apostles had grown up with all of these laws about what they were allowed to eat and what they weren't. And when they went out into these villages, they didn't know if they were going to get something that was kosher, what we would call kosher, or not. But Jesus said, eat what they put in front of you. I want to read something to you that probably has never been read from this pulpit in all of its 200 and some years, but you'll recognize it. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, and they are endowed by their Creator certain unalienable rights. That among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their powers from the consent of the governed. That whenever any government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter it. So that's from the Declaration of Independence. It was written by Thomas Jefferson. And even though Thomas Jefferson is the one of our founding fathers who used the language of separation of church and state, he firmly posits the strength of the state in God, not in a religion, not in a church, but in God. Now, our founding fathers were limited. Okay, they weren't evil men. But they were brought up from the time they were children to believe that women were little more than property, and black people just were property to be bought and sold. They didn't know anything else. And it would not be good for us just to write them off and write off everything they ever said or did because of that. Had they grown up in our time, they may have said, we hold these truths to be self-evident that all people are created equal and endowed by their Creator. Then he goes on to say that governments are instituted in order to help the people in life, liberty, the pursuit of happiness, and other rights that are endowed by God. We have a problem in our time. That people take whatever they think to the extreme end. And then they complain about the other people who take to the other extreme end. And yet, both Thomas Jefferson in his Declaration of our Independence and Scripture call for the same thing. And that is that it's on us to feed and clothe the stranger. need. So two problems occur. One is that people are afraid they're not going to get their own stuff. You know, I don't want everybody else getting health care because I don't have good health care. So I got to get mine first. That's one problem. The other is that we are very poor at accepting help from other people. People I know have died because they wouldn't accept help. So when I do spiritual direction and I talk to people about their lives and how they understand God, and I give them homework every week, I've told you that before, and I say, let somebody help you do something, they're like, whoa, I can't do that. People in this congregation have refused to ride to church, even though it was on somebody else's way, because it would be too much trouble. Then we all lose. We all lose that person being here. There is enough in this country that everybody can eat. Everybody can have good water to drink. Everybody can have a place to live. If we stopped thinking about, when am I going to get mine? And how can I help? How can I be helped? So when folks talk about separation of church and state, the intent of that is that I do not impose my prayers on other people in the public square, unless I'm invited. Neither does a Hindu person get to do that, or a Muslim person, or anyone else. I do not get to force my belief on people in the public square, and neither does anybody else. But apparently, according to Thomas Jefferson, we are all called for the good of the people. And that's exactly what the gospel says. Take care of each other. Love each other. Institute a government that loves and cares for its people. And then make it accountable to do that. Institute a church, a congregation, that loves and cares for its people. And then make it accountable that we do that. Praying always in Jesus' name and through the Spirit. Amen.
Thank you. united in Christ and guided by the Spirit, we pray for the church, the creation, and all in need. Lord of the harvest, you send your church into the world to proclaim Christ's new creation to all. Renew the church as it carries out your mission of peace and healing. We pray for missionaries who accompany your people. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Your creation abounds with flowing waters and diverse creatures. Guide the work of climate scientists as they develop and advocate ways to restore Earth's natural balance. Motivate humankind to adopt lifestyles that protect and sustain the Earth. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
You guard the nations. Let no leaders exalt themselves, but lift up the most vulnerable and work for the good of all. Send your Spirit to eradicate classism and inequity, violence and war, poverty and hunger. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
You desire abundant life for all. As we celebrate Independence Day, instill in us gratitude, generosity, and persistence in working toward freedom for all people. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Mothering God, you care for all people in need. Nourish those who are hungry. Restore employment to those who have lost work. Heal those who are sick. And comfort all who are dying or grieving. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
We remember the saints who proclaimed your reign on earth and now rest in you. Make us faithful in our witness to Christ's new creation. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of every time and place, in Jesus' name and filled with your Holy Spirit, we entrust these spoken prayers and those in our hearts into your holy kingdom.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
We share a socially distant sign of peace. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me."
Give us today our daily bread.
Mm-hmm.